Hello there. It's great to be here with you, although I have to say, after this summer's World Cup, being a British person in Croatia is a bittersweet experience. I've balanced that by sitting next to the Swedish people. But thank you for the Croatian national football team for giving us a lesson in humiliation, because those things are going to come in really helpful when we Brexit next year. So this palace is something we're very proud of, it's something I'm very personally proud of, and I'd like you to consider it in two ways. One is an experiment in how immersive an experience you can give someone without a screen, and the second is the magic that happens when you create meaningful collaborations with artists and trust them to tell your stories with you. So we're historic royal palaces. We look after the six unoccupied royal palaces in the UK. We welcome 5 million visitors a year, and we are entirely self-funding, so we receive no government or crown funding. Just closer. Ah, there we are. I work in the public engagement department. We see ourselves as somewhere between theatre and a museum. Palaces have always been places of performance and spectacle, and they've always used the best artists of their generation. So it's a daunting task to follow in those footsteps. And when it comes to technology, people come to palaces to travel back in time. So we need to make sure that whatever technology we use doesn't distract from that. So I'm going to talk you through the project, the results, the process we followed, some of the challenges and lessons we learnt. So brace yourselves in 15 minutes. This is Banqueting House, where it starts. We think it's the best room in London. The entire ceiling is painted by Rubens. But the problem with this room is that there are 1,499 rooms missing, because it's this building, it's the last remaining part of Whitehall Palace, which burnt to the ground 300 years ago. So this was once the biggest palace in Europe, bigger than Versailles, and some of the stories that happened here really are the greatest hits of British history. It's where Henry VIII met Anne Boleyn, it's where he married her, it's where Shakespeare premiered many of his plays, etc., etc. And in terms of links to the present, our Prime Minister lives on Downing Street, our government sits on Whitehall, and they sit there because Whitehall Palace was once the seat of royal power there. So this continuation of past to present is very apparent. So how did we do that? How did we do this? This is just a 1.5 minute introduction to the Lost Palace.
What is this debauchery that I hear tell of at the cock inn for which you are indicted?
Talk not between the dragon and his wrath!
Sarah!
Have you heard? The king is now besotted with Queen Catherine's...
Both that you may marry and that I may join you together in marriage.
Into a madman.
Show over here.
And it was Her Majesty. Catherine of Braganza.
Yes.
Come on, Rochester. Break it. Come on, smash it.
Dread ocean haze.
Remember.
So it was a self-guided tour of a palace that no longer exists, and it combined audio theatre, location-based technology, live performance, and architectural installations. And this was the team that made it. The interaction designers Chomko and Rosier, theatre company Uninvited Guests with sound artist Lewis Gibson, and software engineers Calvium. Now, there is a lot of technology. I'm afraid there is a phone, actually. There is a phone, but it's a phone hacked to a microprocessor with NFC, GPS, and all of the gesture recognition from the phone. But it's all hidden. So the interface for the user is this wooden block. The other key technology is binaural sound. Binaural sound is a way of recording sound in the way that the human brain perceives it. So we're very good at working out which direction a sound is and how far away it is. So this is the binaural microphone, and our actors perform to that microphone, and then when you listen back through headphones, it sounds like they're moving around you. So it's a big change, because rather than listening to audio as you're listening to it, with binaural sound, you're actually standing in it, and the characters from the past can talk to you directly and implicate you. So it starts in Banqueting House with a projection mapped model and walls that show how the palace changed over time, and then everything is destroyed in flames, all the surrounding walls around you, time to leave. You then follow the route, follow the guided instructions that are given through the device around central London. Around the route, you encounter 8 architectural installations. Now, these were inspired by the bits of architecture that would have stood in that spot, and they're all burnt wood. The idea is that they're the charred remains of the palace after the fire. And these are all lined with NFC tags. And we also have this live performer. So this is an actor playing the role of a busker, and he's singing a contemporary version of a 16th century song. And when you're wearing the headphones, you can hear him, but when you take the headphones off, you can't. He's miming. So what we're really trying to do is play with people's perceptions of what is the past, what is the present, what is being delivered through the device, and what's the noise of the real world. So there's 4 main interactions. When we can take you to the place where the historic story happened, we do, and we put an installation there, and you touch the device to it, and it triggers the scene that happened through that doorway, through that threshold. If we cannot take you to the place, then the device becomes like a surveillance device that scans and locates the stories where they happened. The third is that it becomes, sometimes you have to physically take part in the scene. So you saw in the film the sword fight this is during the daytime for families, and we also did an adults only evening version. So for the evening version, the device became a cockerel that you had to shake and throw into the ring for a cockfight, which is a true historic fact, but a very funny thing to be doing stood on the street in central London. And the final interaction is using haptics, and this really was the showstopper, that during the scene, which was the execution of Charles I, the device starts to beat with a human heartbeat that you actually feel in your hands. And you're listening to the final moments of Charles I's life, and when the axe falls at the point of execution, it stops beating. So the responses were, we were just blown away, and these are the responses to the different elements of it. So the technology, storytelling, and practical delivery all were rated above 94% as effective or very effective. And the more emotional responses too, so 93% strongly agreed or agreed that it was unique to other visitor experiences, 95 that it brought the history to life, and 91 that it made them feel connected to the history that was there. We also brought in a new visitor age or visitor range. 38% were aged 16 to 34, and 59% were under 44. And I'd like to introduce you to my second favourite Lost Palace visitor. Number one's coming soon. We had some really great media reviews from the BBC. Museums Journal said, buzzwords such as immersive, innovative, and intuitive can be overused, but in this instance, they feel justified. And Time Out said, more attractions should be creating experiences like this. As you'll know, because I'm stood here, we've won a few awards for this. What was a kind of unexpected result was unsolicited comments from visitors. So this lady, this is my favourite Lost Palace visitor, just emailed in to us. And I've put this in because she describes almost exactly what we set out to do in her own words, which she says, I was amazed how easily modern life drifted to the background whilst the past became more vivid and alive around me. My daughter, age 15, who accompanied me, was also thrilled by the tour. And really unexpected was the fact that people, after the experience, it inspired their own creativity. So this is an illustrator who produced an illustration on the experience. So around, you can see all the different bits of the Lost Palace in cartoon form. So this was a different type of experience for us, and it required a different type of process. And rather than saying, this is how we will do it, we asked the creative industries, how can we do this? So we ran an open call competition. From the competition, we funded and built 5 prototypes that we tested with real audiences that we recruited through social media. And then the 2 most popular prototypes were asked to form a collaboration. And for the next slide for collaboration, I've thought it's not always easy working together and people who come from different backgrounds. So I searched for a picture about people getting on okay in difficult circumstances. And there's one from quite recently. That's the England football captain, in case for those who don't know. The collaboration then develops on an iterative design process with 15 rounds of user testing. And as you can imagine, in central London, in these times of heightened security, we had to do a huge amount of work with the security, the police and the security forces in the area. Marketing this type of experience and to this audience proved a challenge, and traditional methods didn't cut through. And in fact, nearly 50% of people came because through word of mouth from family and friends. And it's messy. This is not a kind of standard heritage way of working. We also, back to Brexit, Whitehall is the street where Britain goes to protest, so it was often very lively around the Lost Palace routes. This is an anti-Brexit campaign march. And I'll just finish with the lessons we have learnt from this. And through the next set of slides, all the comments are from visitors, either from social media or from surveys. So we're operating in an experience economy. People don't come to find out facts and figures. They go to Wikipedia for that. They come because they want an experience that is social, that is emotional, and that is, well, probably shareable. The user-human interface, by removing the screen, removing buttons and all of that kind of stuff, you put people's bodies in the story. So if in order to trigger the content they have to touch physical objects against each other or do an action with their own bodies, they're actually in it, they're participating, and it kind of, we find that immersed them far deeper than we expected. We learned that you don't need visuals to augment reality, and you don't need visuals to take people to a virtual reality either, although someone did choose to put a Pokemon underneath one of the installations. We learned that narrative, a really good story, well told, is as powerful a dynamic as a game mechanism for taking people around this sort of thing. And I think underneath all of this is a belief that if we want people to really understand the past in a meaningful way, we need them to connect personally, emotionally with characters. We need them to feel empathy. And those are stories, you know, they're the big stories of hopes and dreams, of love, sex, death and power. But what we found is that if you use technology to stimulate a variety of senses, so touch, sound, vision, and combine these, the visceral response that it generates actually enables that emotional connection, because it's actually people's bodies telling them the story, not just their minds. So really what we're doing here is, rather than designing the experience or the moments of the experience for what we want people to do or what we want people to learn, actually this is about what we want people to feel. What do we want them to feel about that story? Because that's the route into understanding it, to connecting with the characters. And I'm going to rattle through this. The main legacy of the project is a kind of commitment to research and development as a way of working. And we've actually dedicated physical space to this. We have a 3-room R&D studio at Hampton Court Palace now, where we invite artists in to become residents and to explore and play with us. We're working in VR and motion capture at the moment, but I'm pleased to say that it's not just digital stuff. And through R&D, we are now telling history through drag queens, feminist cabaret troupes, And I'll leave you with this piece of emotional blackmail. So this is Isaac, aged 8, and please don't let Isaac down because he thought the Lost Palace was amazing. Thank you.
Thank you, Tim.